Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome everyone to the services here this morning. Especially want to welcome any visitors we may have. Just ask if you could to fill out the tab on the side of the bulletin and drop it in the offering plate when it comes around. If you're a first-time guest of ours, we want to welcome you with a special gift bag we've arranged. But we need you to raise your hand up really high at this time, and one of these ladies will get that to you. For his announcements today, I was asked to announce that there will be no work day this coming up Saturday for the outdoor drama, but we will have costume fittings for the outdoor drama next Sunday, and that will happen right after morning service, morning church, and before and after evening service. So if you're part of the outdoor drama, be sure to get back there and get your costume fitted. And if you have any more questions or need more info, see Nancy Newman. I do have a couple of cards here I'd like to read. It says, no words can even express our sincere appreciation for all the prayers, visits, phone calls, cards, etc. Before, during, and after Jerry's recent surgery. We don't know how people survive during difficult times without the love of God and the love of a church family. Again, we thank you. Through the warmth and kindness of special people like you, thank you and God bless. And that's from Jerry and Sandy Butler. It's good to see Jerry back with us today. It says, to the wonderful cooks, I don't know your names, but I know you can cook. The food Sunday was wonderful, and you did all of that on a short notice. You are all truly a host of angels. Thank you so much. It was truly appreciated, and that was the family of Ruby Evans. And that's all I have today. Do we have any birthdays this past week? Birthdays, there we go. Anniversaries.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
My word for the word for this Sunday, November 2nd, do you believe it's already November? I can't. It's from Psalms 95, verses 1 and 2. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. Let us pray. Father, we do thank you for this day you've blessed us with, and we thank you for this time that we have together in your house to worship you, Father. And we ask for your continued blessings upon this service, that you'll bless Brother John as he brings a message from your holy word. You'll bless Sister Pam and her choir, Father, as we just sing songs of joy to you, Father. And we just pray that you'll just continue to bless us. You'll watch over us and be it the ones that's not here for whatever the reason. We just pray that you'll just return them back to your house once again to worship you. We pray also for the lost, Father, throughout our church and through our community, Father. We just pray that you just will convict them, Father, and that they'll see the light, Father, and they'll come to you before it's eternally too late. And we just pray that you guide and lead always. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Redeemed, our love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I know that the light of his presence with me does continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I think of my blessed redeemed. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I will serve thee because I was nothing before you found me. You have given life to me.
Y'all stand with us. We're going to do our praise and worship duty these days of Elijah.
Thank you.
God like Jehovah. There's no 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 God like Jehovah. Behold me come, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, hear a jubilee, out of science in salvation comes. Behold me come, riding on the cloud, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, hear a jubilee.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we're thankful to be in your house today and to worship you and your Son, Jesus. We ask you today to bless this offering, bless our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all worship with me as I sing Redeemed.
Couldn't hear it. already been won. I am redeemed. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. Of my shame and regret. But when I hear you whisper, child, lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. I am redeemed. You said me. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be, because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, 'cause his day is long dead and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. Oh God, I'm not who I used to be. Jesus, I'm not who I used to be. For I am redeemed. Mm-hmm. Thank God, redeemed.
Thank you, Pam. So good to be with you this morning. If you have your Bibles, open them up to the book of Proverbs, chapter 18. We're talking about small things that make a big difference. And today I want to talk about our words. We talked about in the first message a word. Then we talked about a thought. Now we're talking about a group of words. And we know that little bitty things make a huge, huge difference. In fact, if you're going to be successful in big things, you have to do the small things well. You have to focus on those and recognize how important they are. And words matter. What you say has power of life or death. And you have the ability within yourself to kill with words. So we need to understand how important they are. My brother, just older than me, is a counseling psychologist. He teaches at university up in New York. And he was a decent student going through school. He wasn't like the top of his class, but he was a decent student. And there was a lady in his class that was an outstanding student, brilliant lady. She dropped out of college. He continued on. And he wrote his dissertation and got his PhD. And he teaches now. The first time he came back, after he had his PhD, they had a class reunion. And this fellow student said to him, "Well, I just don't understand it. I'm a lot smarter than you are. And I don't have a degree and you have a doctorate. And Chan came home and he told me that. And I said, you know, the whole point of life is not how bright you are, but it's how determined you are. And the words that she tried to give were words of death. But the words that we need to give are the words of life. We need to build one another up, and we need to understand how important it is to build ourselves up too. And there's an important principle that I want you to get. And we deal with words today and with thoughts we've talked about, but there's power in words. Think about the power behind these words. In John chapter 1, in verse 1, and then verse 14, it said, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelled among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." There is such power in words. And we need to recognize that. And when we have God-ordained words, there is incredible power there. So I want to give you some God-ordained words today. Stand with me as we read our passage of Scripture and then begin today. Proverbs chapter 18 and verse number 21 says, "Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit." Father, bless the reading of your words and help us, Lord, to recognize the power of words. Help us to love one another, to encourage one another, and to make a difference in the lives of others. Thank you, Lord, for the small things that make such a big difference. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Words that we speak can be life-giving words. Our words that we speak can be death-taking words, or life-taking words. If you want to change the life that you have, what you need to do is change your speech. Change the words that you use. Now, in James chapter 3, verses 3, 4, and 5, it says these words, "We can make a large horse go wherever we want by what?" By means of a what? Say it with me. Small. One more time. Small bit in its mouth. And a small rudder makes a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go. Even though the winds are strong, in the same way, the tongue is a thing that makes grand speeches, but a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. James is saying small things make a big difference. Little bitty, seemingly insignificant things have the power of life or have the power of death. And we need to recognize that in our own lives. Listen, you show me a struggling marriage, and I'll guarantee you within that marriage there are life-taking words being spoken. You show me a marriage that's on the rocks, that's failing, and that's struggling, and I'll show you a marriage where there's life-taking words. But you show me a marriage that's doing well. You show me a healthy marriage, and I'll show you a marriage where there's an abundance of life-giving words, where we build one another up and we don't tear one another down. Now, take someone that you don't like to be around because they make you feel unimportant or small. Or you take a boss that drives you crazy. What you're going to find in those relationships will be a lot of life taking words, a lot of negativity, a lot of destruction. But on the other hand, you take someone that you love to be around, and you're going to find that they have a lot of words that build you up. They have plenty of life-giving words. They're speaking to you. Now, I want to contrast life-giving words and death-taking words. And Proverbs chapter 12, verse 18, listen to these words. The words of the reckless, they pierce like swords. But the tongue of the wise brings healing. Did you notice the contrast there? Listen, you can hurt, you can pierce with your words, or you can build up and heal with your words. The right words are wonderful. The wrong words are horrible. In Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 4, it says, "The soothing tongue is a tree of life, but a perverse tongue crushes the spirit." It just takes the life out of someone. Listen, how many have been crushed by words? How about these words? I can't stand you. I just can't stand you. How about these? I found somebody else. How about these? I never loved you anyway. How about this? You're pathetic. Don't those just bring you down? Those are life-taking words. How about this? I wish I had never had you. Life-piercing words. They pierce like a sword. But many of us have been blessed also by life-giving words. How about these? I'm proud of you. Doesn't that make you want to smile? I'm proud of you. You're the best of the best. Here's the words I said to Sandy when we recommitted I renewed our marriage vows 25 years, standing right behind where I'm at with Brother Almond. My word, he said, "Do you want to say anything?" And Sandy was crying and couldn't. I don't know if she was crying because she was renewing or or crying over the past 25 years that were spoiled. I don't know. But I said to her, "I want to say something." Here were my words. "If I had 1,000 lives to live, I would give every one to you." And I meant that. If I had 1,000 lives to live, I would give every life to her. I would marry her in every life. You see, we need to build people up. We need to say things like this: "You are my dream come true." Or, "I am so thankful that God put you in my life." Words that heal, words that build up, words that give hope, words that give health, words that give life. Every time I go away for an overnight or I have to leave early in the morning and we don't get a chance to visit much, Sandy always puts notes in my pocket. And I find them. Here's one of them. This happened this week. She doesn't know I was going to do this. But just a little note, just a little thing, you see. Nothing big, but just a little thing. We call each other strange names. Hey, not like that. I started this, and she calls me every now and then Sue. She said, "Thank you for serving God, His people, and loving him and them like you do." And then she underscored this word, "You're a great example of a Christian." And then she added this last life-giving statement, "You make me proud." I can do anything. And then she said, "I love you," and signed it, Fred, because Fred is what I call her. But those are life-giving words. Life-giving words. And we have a box. I made a box a long time ago, and I gave one to both of my children. And I said, "Write love notes and letters to your spouse. And after you read them, put them in the box." Put them in the box. Because one day, You're going to wish you had those. And you can open that up and you can go back through that. Life-giving words. Words that we all need. Words that build us up. Our words. Listen. Our words. Two things I want to share with you. Our words spoken to others first. Let me give you this. I'm going to give you another one of these tests, a word audit test, if you will. Last week I gave you a thought audit. This week I'm going to give you a word audit. First are our words spoken to others. There's life-giving and life-taking. Now, where do you fit on that scale? Are your words spoken to others? Are your words life-giving, down 1, 2, 3, or life-taking, 7, 8, 9, 10? Where are you at? I mean, the words you speak to those you love the most, where do they fall? Where are you at? I hope they are life-giving words. And if they're not life-giving words, you need to change it from life-taking words to life-giving words. You don't need to be negative. Negativity repels people. We need to be positive. How do we do this? Well, here's negative words. Why is your room always such a mess? You say, oh, it's a statement of fact. Well, it's very negative. Here's one that happened in our house quite often. I've tried to be better. You always leave the toilet seat up. How about this word? You're pathetic. Or you make me crazy. Now think about it. Those are life-taking words. But life-giving words would be something like this. I am so proud of you. You are the best. You are the best. Thank God for you. Those are life-giving words. To others, we need to have life-giving words, encouraging words, edifying words. Now, what about to ourselves? Because we talk to ourselves. And we talk to ourselves often. We have life-taking words and life-giving words. 1 to 10, where do you range on that scale? Do you ever say to yourself, you are such an idiot? Oh, yeah. Or you can't do anything right. Or why do you always screw up? You're a moron. How about changing that to life-giving words that you speak to yourself? You can do this. You can do this. How about these? This way, I love these. I put these up there. You the man. Or the lady. Or I love my life. Why not do that? How many times do we speak more negative words to ourselves and to others? Listen, if you couldn't put down tens, there's room for improvement for you. You need to improve in the language that you use and the words that you speak. Why? Because there is power in our words. So I want you to change the way you speak, and I want you to make small changes, and these small changes are going to make a big difference in your life and in the lives of those that you speak to, because it's the small things that make the big difference that everybody wants. People say, John, you and Sandy have a wonderful marriage. How do you have that? Life-giving words. Praying together. Staying together. Words have power of life and death. Let me give you two rules about life-giving words. This is a very simple message. Two rules about life-giving words. The first one I'm not going to focus on too long, but just a little bit, enough for you to understand what I'm saying. If you can't say something helpful, skip it. If you can't say something helpful, skip it. Skip it. Now, if that doesn't convict you, you're not paying attention. Listen, if some of you apply this one thought out of Ephesians chapter 4, verse 29 to your life, it will change your life. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it may do what? May impart what? What? You can do better than that. That it may impart what? Grace to the hearers. Listen, build people up. Speak words of power that have life build people up. And if you do that, it will change your life. It'll change your marriage. It'll change your relationship. It will change your life. Because when we speak words, there is power. Now, it's at this point that you may be thinking, yeah, if my spouse would speak those kind of words, I would speak those kind of words. Here's what I want you to understand. I'm not talking to your spouse, I'm talking to you. So don't elbow your spouse, elbow yourself. Listen, don't elbow your child, don't elbow your parent, or you're really in trouble. But realize, there's power of life. Now, the second thing, I told you I wasn't going to major on the negative because you know I'm not a negative person. So I'm going to major on the positive. The second rule is this. If you think something good, say it. If you think something bad, basically do what? Skip it. If it's not going to edify, not going to build up, skip it. Leave it alone. But if you think something good, what are you going to do? Say it. Say it. Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 24, gracious words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. Listen, that builds you up. Those pleasant thoughts, those positive thoughts, pleasant words from God's word. Listen, I don't want to focus on negativity in my life. It's too short. I don't want to be critical of my life. It's too short. I want to use godly, positive things that will bring power into the people's lives that I speak and give them hope. And if you want a bumper crop of positive words and thoughts that come back to you, then you need to sow the seed. If you don't sow any seed of positive thoughts, of godly thoughts, of grace-filled thoughts, of gracious words, and all of the things that you want in return, you're not going to have a harvest. But if you sow criticism and negativity and cynicism and all of these things, guess what crop you're going to harvest? I mean, it's going to be a bountiful crop of negativity, and it's life-taking. Listen, sometimes, you know, people respond to things differently. Josh and I, we love to play golf together. If you don't know who Josh is, that's our son. So sometimes when it comes to our communication on the phone, I'll say strange things to him and he'll say strange things to me, kind of like this. We'll use a golf metaphors. He may have an important meeting and I'll say, buddy, you're going to knock it 300 yards down the center of the fairway. You're going to rip that drive. And he'll tell me something later, something good that happened, and I'll say, man, you just sank a putt from off the green. Or when he has a video conference that he has that's pretty major, I'll say, well, here, son, keep it in the short grass. Now, for those of you that aren't golfers, you have no idea what I'm talking about. But those that are golfers, you know what I'm saying. Listen, when you think something good, say it. People get so low. And they think they don't matter. Let me tell you, many of you know the name Kevin Murray. Kevin is one of my good friends. He's been up here to preach for us and sing for us many times. When I left Piggott, just about to leave Piggott, the church that he had taken there, he was under fire. And I mean, it was bad. And he didn't think he was going to make it. And his life was spiraling out of control. So I sat down and I wrote him a letter. And I took that letter and I gave it to him. I said, Kevin, when you have time, read this. That's 20 years ago. You know what? He still has that letter. And when he gets low, he pulls that letter out and he reads it again. And you know what he says? I am of value. God created me and I am worth something. And I will overcome. Listen, the words that we speak, the words that we say, the words that we write have power. Listen, we need to do that. We need to encourage one another. We need to build one another up. I've wondered so often, what if I had just said, you know, I don't have time to write him a letter. He knows how I feel. What about you? What about you? Have you taken the time? You see someone that's struggling, someone that needs a little bit of affirmation, a little bit of encouragement. Why don't you go the second step, pick up the phone, and make a phone call? Why don't you send a text or an email or put pen to paper and write an old-fashioned letter? Do something. When you say it, when you think it, say it. Let them know. Listen, if you want a blessing back, you've got to be a blessing. Don't rob somebody else by not giving words of life. Now, you can think of it. If you don't say it or you don't do it, it doesn't mean anything. King David, one of the lowest points in his life. He was going to be stoned. He was running for his life. And I want you to see what David did. David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But I want you to get this last line. But David, what did David do? Did he look for someone else to strengthen him? No, there wasn't anybody around. So you know what David did? What you and I have to do sometimes. David strengthened himself in the Lord his God. David said, you know what? I'm going to strengthen myself in God. I am going to come to the throne, and I'm going to ask God to give me strength because I know that I am of value. Listen, he encouraged himself with words of life and affirmation, and sometimes you just need to build yourself up. And you say, God, you're going to have to get me through this, but I believe and I know it's going to happen, so I'm going to continue moving forward. God, your hand's upon me. God, you want good things for me, and you want to bless me and encourage me, and I want to bless others and encourage them. So God, I'm going to encourage myself in you. If you want to see it happen, you need to say it. Now, say what you want to say, what you want to see. Say it. Say it. Now, let me pause. Time out. Because I don't want you to get the wrong thought here. Okay? I am not saying, God, I see a Bentley in my driveway. That is not what I'm saying. I am not saying name it, claim it. That is not what I'm saying. So please don't misunderstand that. But I'm saying whatever is consistent with God's truth, believe it. God, I believe you want to bless my marriage. Say it. God, I believe you want to bless my marriage. And then you say it. God, I believe you want to bless my business. And I'm going to give this business to you. Say it. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 17 and verse 20, he said, because of your unbelief, for assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say, not about, but to this mountain, move from here and there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. But you just have to say it to. Look at Ezekiel chapter 37. And when the valley of the dry bones, again he prophesied and said, prophesy to these bones and say, not about them, but say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. God, by faith, I believe that you can, if it is your will, heal the person that I am praying for. So I am praying for them. I want to give you now a small, life-changing phrase. I gave it to the deacons in training this morning, but if you'll apply this, you'll be amazed at what it will do in your life. It will change your life. It'll change your words. It will change the power of the things that you say. It will make such a big difference with small things, and it will change the way that you speak because there is power in our words. Every time, listen, I don't want you to miss this. Every time you speak, I want you to apply this to the end of it. When you say something, here's what I want, and you mean it with all your heart, I want you to say this phrase, and that's the way I want it. And that's the way I want it. For example, when you're talking about your marriage, don't say, I'm so sick and tired of my marriage. I know it's going to end in divorce, and that's the way I want it. Because it will. It will. It will. My kids are losers, and they'll never amount to anything, and that's the way I want it. You see the power there? You see it? Do you see that? You'll never amount to anything, and that's the way I want it. That's what you want. That's what you're saying. So you have to transform that. You may have to say, God, my marriage isn't what it needs to be today, but I'm going to give it to you. And every single day I'm going to speak life-giving words. And I'm going to have a fabulous marriage. And that's the way I want it. That ought to get an amen. Amen. Seriously. Your words are powerful. Instead of saying, I just can't do anything and that's the way I want it. Say, you know, through Christ I can do all things because He strengthens me and that's the way I want it. All things work together for good to those who love God, those called according to His purpose, and that's the way I want it. I am more than an overcomer in Christ Jesus my Lord, and that's the way I want it. You see, there's power in that. Say this. And many of you need to say this. God, I am deep in debt right now, and I feel like I am swimming and I am sinking, but God, I'm going to work my way through this and out of this by being frugal and godly and doing things your way, and then I'm going to be a tither, and then I'm going to be generous. I'm going to help others that are struggling, and that's the way I want. God, I'm just always going to be in this cyclical pattern, spin and sink and never really get anywhere, and that's the way I want it. That's what you want. That's what you'll get. God, renew my life. Renew my marriage. And God, that's the way I want it. Small things make a big difference. So what I want you to do is renew your words. Renew your thoughts. How? You ever been to an airport and gone through a magnometer? You say, what is a magnometer? That's that thing you go in. Okay, you ever been through one of those? All right, they want you to take everything off. I mean, almost everything off now. Here you go. You're going through this magnometer, okay? So you step in, it goes, I said, do you have metal on? Step back out. Oh, yeah, got a couple of coins. Take the coins out. Step back through. Step back out. What else do you have? What? I got a wallet. Okay. I'm ready to go now. Step through. What else do you have on? Got my shoes. Step through. No, I'm not going any further. But listen. Here's my point. There are some things that we need to get rid of in our life that are causing us to be type of people. And that magnometer goes off, and all you can think about is, man, here comes Mr. Negative or Miss Negative. And every time they're around, you hear the Listen, I want you to be able to go through that magnometer, and it doesn't beep because you have life-giving words. Don't go through there and say, And how are you treating your wife? Great. You go in there, back out. No, I'm not really treating her so great, but I'm going to change the way my words are. Then you go again. It's like, how are you treating your husband? Oh, he's awesome. God, help me to treat my husband as I should. Forgive me, and that's the way I want it. You see, life-giving words, and you're able to go through life, and it's not negative, but it's positive, and it's godly, and it builds up. Listen, you're there in the magnometer, and here you are standing before Almighty God. Brother John, have you spoken any critical words about anyone lately? No, God. Yes, I did. I was really on George the other day. I didn't mean to, but you know. Confess it. Life-giving words. How we think, how we speak. Now, If we'll improve our words, we will improve our life, we'll improve our marriage, we'll improve our home, we'll improve our relationship, we'll improve our church, we'll improve our community, we will improve our world. Why? Because Jesus Himself gave life-giving words. Whosoever believes on the Son of Man shall not perish but have everlasting life. Listen, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Jesus said, I have come that they may have abundant life. So here's the point. What do you want? And when you decide what you want, you intensify it with this statement. And that's the way I want it! Exclamation point. I'm going to live a godly life, and that's the way I want it! Exclamation point. I'm going to have a wonderful marriage, and I'm going to teach our children how to love one another and love God. And that's the way I want it. Exclamation point. What do you want? Because what you want is what you'll get. And as you think, so you'll speak, and so you'll become. Many of you are going to walk out and go, man, you just told on yourself? What do you want? What do you really want? What do you want? Tell you what I want. I want more of these. And I want to give more of these. But that's a choice. What's yours? Every head bowed and every eye closed. Listen, Jesus Christ spoke life-giving words to you. And He said, here, come to Me, all you that labor heavy laden, and I will give you rest. But you have to make the decision to come. And when you make the decision to come, He says, cast your cares on Me because I care for you. And I'll take your burden. I'll be your burden bearer. But you have to come to Me. Listen, would you come to Christ today? He'll change your life. He'll change your words. He'll change your thoughts. People will gravitate toward you, not be repelled by you. Listen. You say, oh, Brother John, I'm not going to come and pray down there at the altar. Somebody will think I'm negative. Let me tell you something, sir. They know. Ma'am, they know. If you're giving life-giving words, people know. And if you give life-taking words, people know. Listen, just simply come and say, Lord, I want things to change, and that's the way I want it. And then change. Father, I pray for men, women, boys, and girls' lives, for their souls, for their future. I pray for each of us that we might be more of what we should be and less of what we are. And I pray we would honor You with our thoughts and with our words. We would encourage others and build them up and even edify ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you please stand?